I was playing with some notes down here at midnight in the dark. And just, yeah, doing it like this. Can you hear it? You know, those are the two notes that are supposed to be there, but when we do it, I hear this. With this. And then bring it down an octave. Brings us to these notes, all those notes right there. But those two notes bring some type of harmonics with these two notes. Going the opposite direction. We're going down the scale there, but the two harmonic notes are going upscale. And they're two different notes. Wild stuff, man. That's what it's called at night, getting sensitive to the guitar, you know. I mean, I get so sensitive at night sometimes. This last night that I was doing it, I could feel my eardrums shaking in my head, and it was disturbing. It was so disturbing I had to quit playing. Because my whole head was just rattling just by making the slightest noise on the guitar. You know, when all the noise is silent at night, when we can hear nothing but the high-pitched shrill of the power lines. What a wonderful sound that is. Oh my fucking God. I had discovered that a long time ago, but it had just come back to my mind. So it cycled, the planet cycled back around. Al DiMeola became famous because he was able to play fast on an acoustic guitar, where a lot of people in his day could only probably do it on electric. And they probably couldn't even do it on electric. It would be my guess. Because I think Al DiMeola is like the same generation as Eric Clapton. They were doing all slow blues. That's why he became famous. The first one to be able to outspeed an electric guitar player on an acoustic guitar. Might have been his claim to fame. So here we are with number four box again. We've just analyzed what our fingers just went ahead and did. Now, that's one thing that I've noticed that I'm becoming proficient at, and that's just totally just experimenting with all different notes. Whenever I land on a note, just totally add different notes to it, or one fret down, one fret higher. Mm-hmm. You know, just totally get used to all the different sounds that there are, instead of, you know, the regular old stick to the same key, same notes all the time type thing. I'll just and I saw the light, you know, one day when I was doing it. I was like, you know, you do a regular scale like this. You know, that note, which is not part of the scale, is a note in a different key, but it can be a number of different notes in many different keys. You know, and one note of an arpeggio in many different keys, so. Like I say, you know, I'm using, that's part of my natural thing that's built in me, is just to, you know, like I said, doing stuff that most people wouldn't do anyway because it doesn't sell on a shelf. But they would, you know, they would probably, behind closed doors, cultivate those sounds, and then once they got cultivated, then bring it to the shelf. But I've always been pretty much, especially in my later years, you know, shelf product stuff is pretty much ruining society. And it's causing all of our musicians to become stagnant. This is why usually the first, you know, couple albums are good, and that's about it. Because they've had already, you know, 20 years of, you know, preparing material for those first two albums, and people often think Randy Rhoads will have been awesome, you know, but he would have faced the same dilemma. That's hard to tell. So yeah, we got a little number four box here in the key of G, rolling it down to that sixth note, and then stuff like that, an open E first string, a harmonic on the second string, and then just grab any old note will do. You know, that shit's cool to do, man, when you're doing heavy metal solos, man. You just, you know, it sounds good when you throw some chords behind it and shit like that. All these wild notes, just grab them from anywhere and just throw them in there. And I remember growing up, you know, friggin' one of the thoughts in my mind was, you know, all these guys going around figuring out, you know, tablature and stuff like that. I thought to myself, you know what? I think it'd be cool just to make a style that no one could tab. They'll try to figure it out. And that's where, that might be in my subconscious where I, you know, just tab that, man. Tab that, you know. You know, when I was young, like about 14, 15, around there, you know, I remember they had this thing called Starlix. and you could pretty much, someone had will teach you your favorite guitar style. And so I had a friend at the time in high school who played guitar too. And he says, "Hey man, you wanna go in together on a Starlix thing?" And I says, "All right." So he buys it and everything, we get it. And I bought the Randy Rhoads one, and he bought like the Eric Lifeson one for Rush and stuff like that. So, you know. And then I would be all, I remember I was at his house one day, I would be all concerned about playing the notes just right, you know. And he would just be improvising it. He just, you know, and he says, you know, just. And to me, that stuck in my mind, you know. I was like, it really isn't that important to hit every note just right. I think that was the beginning of my branching off. And although I did figure stuff out note for note after that, a whole bunch of stuff, you know, because I would just throw on all those 80s heavy metal tapes and records. You know, we had record players back then, you could put the needle on. And I would just go through record after record, just learn every song one right after the other. You know, it'd take me some time, but I would learn them. And then that was it. I never really played them a whole lot, except for when I had the Striper albums, because I threw away all my Aussies and stuff like that. All I had was Striper. And so I remember playing, I only had one record, so that's all I had, you know, would just play Striper all the time. So I played a lot. And, Striper stuff was easy to figure out and easy to play, except for I didn't have no whammy bar, so I just had to make do with just bend the notes what I could. But so I'd play a lot of Striper songs. I'd put the record on and jam out to them and play them all the time, but I haven't played that stuff in years, man. The albums I had, like their first one and Soldiers Under Command, those were the two that I had. But I wasn't really into improvising. Although I would improvise though on my own, just play some chords in the background and just play along to them. I remember kind of doing that. But I really wasn't really into improvising until probably till YouTube came out. 2007, I got started getting on YouTube. And I remember. I remember I had the thoughts go through my mind, cool, I'm going to become famous now, everyone's going to know me now. You know, I thought I was all a good player and stuff like that, but I was a good player in my own little world, though. Everyone else thought, you know, looked at me as a crazy, so I just ignored it all and just continued to do my own thing. But that's when I really started getting into improvising. Says, "Oh, I'm like, yeah, that's cool. I kind of like this, you know." That's when I was all in the money too, you know. To see everybody play for once, man, that was cool, man, because, you know, growing up, I only went to two concerts, you know, or three concerts. I went to a Dio concert, a Striper concert, and another Striper concert, but the first Dio, or the first strike, whoop, here we are, 15, so we'll finish that one.